So good evening.
Good evening.
It's nice that we can continue what we started last night. And I hope we're getting a little bit faster today through the material that I want to share with you in all these days. But let us repeat a little bit and then go to the next step. We want to know, why do we get sick? We want to know how we as humans are put together so that we might understand what is in our life that needs to be satisfied first. And we saw that we cannot orient ourselves according to statistics. We cannot orient ourselves according to uncertain things. We cannot go even according to our own observation. We must surrender or put our own observation under a law that even my observation cannot change. You see, we are sometimes in a situation where we see things and we might think they are possible, while by law they are not possible. Yes? So that's why we need such a firm foundation for what we think, and especially in the case of humanity, we need to know how are we wired, how are we made to work, so that we won't be deceived by that what we already have in this world, a lot of deception. That's why the law is the only reliable thing that we have in the world. Do you agree with me? The law is the only reliable thing that we can rely on. Now, some people say, well, love is the most. Yes, the law comes because the law brings us love. But let's understand, can you convince someone with the idea God is love? Can you convince him that God is love? If you just tell him God is love? No. Because he will say, well, look at the world. Look at what happens. How can this be a God of love? Yes? And I had a patient that says to me, if God allows that my daughter should have breast cancer, I don't believe in him anymore. I said, I understand. Why did she believe in God? Because she believed in God for a reason. But if he does not love her, and he would show her that he does not love her when he allows that her daughter, which is 24 years old, would have breast cancer, then she said, I quit with him because there was a nodule in her breast, left or right, I don't know, of the daughter. And she was afraid it might be a tumor that is cancer. So we need to know, how can I convince a person that God is really love? You know, you must have something to convince a person that God is love. And words will not do it. What is the only thing that can do it?
The law.
Understanding the law gives me today total security that God is love. And I have no doubt about it, because I see that the human being, the physical human being, was made for love's sake and to function with love. So that's why the only power that we can have of conviction and of us being convinced and not be shaken is to have something we cannot change with the way we think. We cannot change with the way we judge things. It must be outside of our reach. And the only thing are the laws of nature. And nature was done by God, so the nature, the way nature works, is an expression of God's love. Isn't that written in a nice little booklet, Steps to Christ? It says that on every plant, it is written the message, God is love. But how can you see it if you don't understand the law behind it? So, let's go to understand this. Truth is equal with law. That's Psalm 119, 142. Truth is equal with law. You can have opinions. Opinions might be based on the truth, then on the law, then they are truth. But if your opinion are not based on the law, then you are shaky. You have no sure foundation. So we must put all our understanding about humanity on this firm foundation, which is not movable by no one, neither by us nor by anyone else. See, I have patients that come to me and they say, well, I see that you're a Christian, and I invite them to counseling. I said, I hope you don't want to bring me, what's the word? You don't want to convert me. And I says, well, if the solution for your life is to think differently, that's conversion. And why would you come to listen to a counsel if you don't want to convert? That is, you want to change something there. But I have no tool in my hand to lead people to conversion, except I show them on their own body the function of the law. And this is here. We have the disease. Disease is a cause or an effect? Can we all say that is an effect? Disease is an effect. And since it is a defect, then it's an effect. Then we know it must have a cause. So we want to know the cause, and we can only know it by the law, because the law says where the effect is, there the cause cannot be. If you get that, that will help you a lot. Okay. And prove it. Okay, where is the effect? The cause cannot be. Because the effect comes as a result of something else coming on that thing. Yeah, it's a basic thing. It will save us all misunderstanding if we just follow it through. Now, let us go a step further. When God created man, or when he created anything that he created on earth, did he create it on a chance level, or he had a purpose for it? Purpose. Yes, so creation has a purpose. But to fulfill that person, you must have certain conditions to be met that you can fulfill that. Yes? So man was made for a definite purpose. And we don't want to go so deep to see exactly the purpose, but we want to understand, what do you need to fulfill the purpose? Do you need something to fulfill the purpose? Yes. You have needs? Yes. The first need to fulfill the purpose is to be alive. Yes? And second is also to be healthy. Yes, if you're not healthy, how much can you fulfill on the purpose? We cannot do it. That's why we must know, to fulfill the purpose, we must be alive. And we must be healthy. To a certain extent, of course, even when you're sick, you can do something, but you cannot do it like you can do it when you're healthy. So, now, the functions of the human body are especially made that we can fulfill the purpose. Okay? Now, function, and I just want to make this somehow clear, I don't know how best. Is function purpose? Is function purpose? No. Yes, function is just needed to fulfill the purpose. I want to give this simple example so that you can follow. We have made cars. And cars has a purpose what? To move us from one place to another. Can the car fulfill the purpose if it doesn't function? No. So the same way, the car must function well so that we can get safe to the place we want to go. That's why when God created humanity, he gave him a certain way to function so that the purpose can be fulfilled. And we want to look to the function that must work so that the purpose can be fulfilled. Because if your car is broken, nothing can work. So what's the function? The function is the way God made us to work. Like the car is made with a lot of cables, yes, so that it can do something. And we want to see a little bit going from the end to the beginning. That is, function has an end. If this is function, then it must start somewhere and it must end somewhere. Yes? So, and this is a concept that I hope we get it. Even I have sometimes problem to explain it. So, what is the end of functioning? That is, what is the ultimate purpose why we eat and drink and think?
Energy.
Well, that's the power that we use. Looking to the body, everything we eat, we drink, where is it? Where is the product goes? Where does the product go?
To build the body.
Yeah, but it has life is already there when we get, but
energy?
Yeah, you're it's good. No, it's good. We have to think because this is a seminar, it's not a sermon. Yeah, we want to grasp the things like they are. What is the organ where
the stomach?
Well, from the mind it starts, and of course it gets back to the mind. You're getting closer. What moves the car? No, the gas is just the power. What moves the car? No.
The
wheels move the car. Okay? So what are the wheels in the human body? The muscles are the wheel. You know, how far do you get if your car is working perfectly and you have no wheels? Or the tire is broken? Do you get anywhere?
No,
because there must be an end thing. You know, the whole energy of that car goes into the
wheels
so that they can move. So the end of the moving are the muscles. How many muscles do we have in our body? Children, what do you think? I think...
600
muscles. Yeah, 600, that's a good... I don't know, there are very many muscles. Everywhere in our body we have muscles. Okay? So, that's why the muscles make us to act. But there is a whole thing. You need a lung so that you can get oxygen to that muscle. You need a liver so that you can get the right chemistry to that muscle. You need a pancreas that you get the sugar out of the blood to the muscle. So everything concentrates its power because the muscle must do the work. I am glad we got to this point. Because this is sometimes very hard for me. Muscle is like this, yes? And there are two things the muscle needs. So if he's the end, so to say, or where the function has to go, then he has a blood vessel that he needs, that he made function. Yes? He must get the right chemistry. But would it be enough to give the muscle the right oxygen, to give the muscle the good glucose, you give him all the chemistry? Would it be enough to move him? No. You all agree with me it's not enough?
Okay.
What do you need for the muscle? You need a nerve for the muscle to come to give him the command. Yes, we need two things. Now, we must know that the nerve works with what kind of power? Yes, the nerves, here it is, the electric. But how far does the electricity go in the nerve? Does it go also in the muscle? Now, this is a little detail. We need to understand there is no electricity that goes into the nerve, into the muscle. There is chemistry that is released here that makes the muscle and the cell move. But until that is released, it is electrical power. So in the end, every unit of functioning is pure chemistry. And you follow that? That's important. We built something that we need to understand. So at the end, we have chemistry. But the muscle will never move on a chemistry that comes through the blood, even it might be. Yeah, we can poison it. Yeah? But the power of the command comes through the nerve. So we need these two things to function. But in the end, all function is chemistry. Yeah? That's why with chemistry we can do a lot of things in our body, but we must understand these two units. The one brings the command and the other brings the chemistry. Now, who is higher and stronger? The nervous system is surrender to the blood, or the blood system to the nerves? So there isn't, they are dependent on each other. You know, the nerves cannot function without chemistry, but the blood vessels do what the nerve says. That's why the human being is so constructed that there is a hierarchy of functioning. Even though everything is dependent on each other, yet there is someone at some place where the things do start. And now we want to see if this is the end of function. Where is the beginning? We see that we have all this we need, and we have many organs that have to prepare the chemistry. And then also, of course, when the muscle has done its work, there is something that needs to be taken back and given out, you know? So then we need to know, where do all processes in our human being start? Physically. You said it before, in the brain, and more more precise, in the brain cortex. And the brain cortex is that outward layer that where every nerve starts. Okay? From there, everything is led into the body from this point. Because here we have billions of nerve cells that give a cord, and that goes into the body. So, if I have a congested nose, if I have a wounded knee, so to say, that is hurting, and I don't find an external thing, no hit, no other external causes, where do I have to look for the cause? For the bringing, for the starting point of it. I have ultimately need to look to the brain. If I can exclude that's an accident, if I can exclude that's a poisoning, if I can exclude that it's the heat or the cold, if I can exclude those outside things, then I must look to the brain. And tell me, when you have a running nose every morning and it stops after an hour or two or a half an hour, how can you grasp that? Where should that start from? When you have a ringing ear one side, how can you grasp that where that comes from? So we need to look more to the whole picture of man to see, when we rule out the external factors, that we say, okay, now what is going on in his mind? What is going on up there? You see, I told you the story of the patient that was surgered on the nose and then he got dizzy. Yes, because he didn't solve the problem. You just do something in the body, but you don't change the cause, you don't get very far off. So there are many surgeries done on the nose, on the septum, to correct it, because almost every septum is not straight. Because God didn't make it straight, it must be, has certain forms so that the air can flow in a certain way. But now you look into the nose of a person and you see a deviation, and you say, oh, this is it, why you don't get air. And so many, about 95% of all surgeries done, the congestion of the nose comes back, statistically. Yeah? But we still want to help the person, so we do the surgery. And then, of course, when you don't get back your congested nose, then you must get another symptom. Mm-hmm. And the people that usually get back their own congestion, and then they do a surgery once or twice. I had a patient that we had done 7 times surgery on his nose. Now his nose was in a terrible mess. Imagine every time someone tries to help him fix the problem, but no one thinks that the problem is the bear. Up here on the thought level. You see, when I was in my training in the hospital, I was there in the ambulance working as a resident, and I had one lady, and she was there with me for 1 year. She came while I had my rotation in the emergency place, and so she became my patient, so I had to take care. She came every 2 to 3 weeks with a very severe infection of the ear canal on both sides. This is a very painful process. If you never had it, you don't know it. I didn't have it yet, but I see the patients, how despaired they are in their pain. So this lady came for 1 year every 2 to 3 weeks with the same symptoms. And I put some stuff in the ear, and I gave her antibiotics, and I asked all my attendees and the chief professor, said, what shall we do with this patient? Because she comes back again and again. And she already did this with the outpatient, the doctor who is out there in his practice, and he couldn't handle her, so he sends her to the hospital. And now I'm here in the hospital, and you see, it was more or about a year, I can't remember exactly, but for a long period, and I was always happy when she didn't come. But when she appeared again, I said, oh no, what shall I do? I was total helpless. But you see, in my total helplessness, I would have never thought, never ever, to think this lady has a burdened heart. I would have never did the connection from her physical to her spiritual situation. I would have never done it. And if one would have come to me and would have said, look, she is sick because she has things going on in her life. That's why her body is sick. I would have laughed about him. I would have said, how shall that be? Because here is an infection. We have bacteria. We have all kinds of things going on. This cannot be from what you think. Yes, I would have just not, I would have ignored the idea at all. But there came the time in my own practice where the Lord had mercy on me. And I'm very happy that now when a person comes with his ear canal infection, I know I have to look higher than the ear canal. There's something going on there. If you have it on both sides, you have two problems at least. But if you have one-sided, it might be one there. Because the ear canal is subject to what the command comes from the brain. And there must be an understanding. How can the command from the brain make the ear canal infection? How can it be? So that is why we must understand if we have recurrent diseases and we try all that we can on that, there must be a cause that we need to ascertain. And we don't even think that it might be her thoughts, do we? We don't even think. Because it's so strange to us, because we were never trained to understand the thoughts of man. Now, do you know where the thoughts are? Are they here at the cortex level, or are they in the center of the brain, where we have our limbic system? What do you think? Where are the thoughts? Where are the thoughts starting? Outside or inside? Now you must look to the law. They must come from outside. Yes? So thoughts are spiritual and they are here. And they, we will see a little bit later, by decision, make the electrical impulse through for the cortex. So thoughts must have in function a clear purpose for the body. And the thoughts are they that give the command for everything that happens in the body. Now, where do thoughts come from? But let's see the emotions or the feelings. The emotions come from the center of the brain, because they are chemicals. And feelings. So, I said this last night, but I say it again because it's something that burdens my heart. We have no emotional needs. We have only spiritual needs. Because the emotions are just the result of what we think in our hearts. The feelings, I would say, are that what the body transmits to the mind, so when he has certain needs. But the emotions are things that are just chemicals. And they are a result of what one thinketh. And they are not, there is no need for emotional things. Okay? We need spiritual things. We need love. But we confuse and call it emotional. And I profoundly hate to be unclear in our understanding or semantics. I don't know how to call that best. So emotions are chemistry. But we have spiritual needs, not emotional needs. But we call the spiritual emotional because in the evolution theory, the limbic system, this place here in the center, is before the cortex. While in function, everything starts from the cortex down to the limbic system. It's not possible to be different. But of course, there is a back and forth between both. One represents the body, the other represents the soul. We'll see a little bit later. So that's why we come up, because how would it sound if you would say, oh, our patients have spiritual needs? How would that sound? How would that sound in a world of where there is no spirit, where there is no things like spiritual things? You see, all the books would need to write and say, oh, man have spiritual needs. Would that sound for a professor who works in a secular? No. Yes? No, but he can say emotional. And with saying emotional, he just gets off, because in psychology, we think love is an emotion. And it is not. Love makes an emotion, but it is never an emotion. Because then God is what? God is chemistry. God is not chemistry. At least the Bible says he's spirit. Yes? So, let us then look to what I discovered after I saw that love is our greatest need. I discovered that there must be something before the cortex. Do you think human life starts at the cortex? No. Human life, only the physical life starts at cortex level. So there must be something above the cortex, here, and only on the cortex level, that gives the cortex the commands so that it works. And I have four proofs that man must have something that we call, or the Bible calls, spirit of man or mind before the cortex. I have never seen a spirit, did you? It's invisible. Yes, like love. Is love visible? No, only if it gets visible in deeds of love. But if not, love is not visible. So righteousness, is righteousness visible? No. So I have four proofs that I want to share with you that must convince us by law that there must be a spirit on the cortex level. Four proofs for the spirit. There might be more. Must be a spirit. So the first proof is the spiritual needs. I came to understand that there are many spiritual needs, but there are a few basic ones that we all have first, and then comes other ones. So we all need righteousness. We all need freedom or liberty. We all need truth. We all need security.
Security.
We all need harmony. We need peace, knowledge, wisdom, recognition, and so on. There are many, many spiritual needs that we have as humans. And now the idea is knowledge. I don't write as well. It's okay. So where do the needs come? Can we have a need that has no one that asks for it? Let me explain. Can you have ever hunger if you don't have a body? No. So I hope that we understand hunger proves that we have a body that needs something. So when we are hungry for righteousness, we prove that we have something in us that carves and asks for that fulfillment. Okay? Now, I could not find in the brain of man any place where you could say, oh, here we have the righteousness area. If this cell don't get righteousness, they die. Have you got that? There is nothing that can, in physical terms, in atoms, there is no need for righteousness. Is there? Did your car ever want to be righteously treated? Yes or no? Why not? Because it has no spirit. It has no need for righteousness. Do you think the plant needs righteousness? Yes or no? No, because it has no spirit, has life, but there's no spirit there that carves for righteousness. Or do you need the plant needs freedom? Or security? Or does it ever get bothered because it stays at the same place? You think the trees in front of the house, you say, oh, I'm so sorry, I have to stay here all the time. No, they have no spirit, they have no knowledge, they have no understanding. They have just a function, and that is set, yes, by the Creator. So there is no place in the whole human physical body where you could say this part of the human body needs freedom or liberty. There is no place like that. So where does it come from then? Can we say that there is something in us physically, our stomach, does our stomach need love? I hope that we all understand that this, I call him altogether love, is not something that you can find as a need in the physical thing. That's why you see the scientists are following their own beliefs very well. They call them emotional needs. And I would love if we as Christians would never call emotional needs again emotional. Because we have another terminology. We know there are spiritual needs. Because righteousness is not no emotion. Freedom, truth, is no emotion. And do you know what's the main cause why people fight for? From all the list, it is righteousness in the end. Because they're also bound together. You find that people fight for righteousness until they die. Yes, freedom is very close. Truth, they might be on the same level as security. I mean, these four, this quartet, I call them, these four, they are the basic things of the human spirit that he needs. And if you go against that, how will he react? He will always be against it. Yeah? He will always be against it. Because these needs are basic. I had a patient who was very sick because he was fighting with his neighbor. He spent already 70,000 euro. That's about $85,000-$90,000. In the court, on the lawyers and the court. He even took the German counselor to work to help him in this righteous issue. He had many physical symptoms. One was that his eyes were running all the time and no one could stop the eyes running. And he was sitting there and I explained him some of this and he said, "Doctor, help me." And I said, "If you stop fighting, your eyes stop running. Can he? Can he?" I had one day a patient, it was at the beginning of my practice, where he was dizzy for 1 month. And his dizziness came every time in the evening when he was working daytime with his chainsaw, he had no issues, no dizziness. But when he came home and sat down, the dizzy came. Only when he came home, the dizziness came. And so he goes to the doctor, and the doctor prescribes him different kinds of medicine, and in 4 weeks he has seen a few doctors, and then finally he comes to me after 4 weeks, and he's very upset and says, "All this medicine don't work." And he puts them in my hand and said, "Doctor, why do I have this dizziness?" He put that question so strong to me, and I was not very thinking at those days, and I just said, as he was asking me so strong, I just said, "Because you have a fight." And he got, and in that moment, after he got a little bit better after the shock that I said, "You have a fight," he said, he started laughing and he said, "You're right. You know what happened 4 weeks before? He had, a few months before, he did work on the house of his parents-in-law, because his parents-in-law have a daughter, and they promised to give the house to the daughter. This man is in his 50s, and 50s, beginning 60s, and he did all the repairing on the house. He used good material, because he thought, for whom does he do it? Because he knows, you know, when you never do on yourself economics. You do it on others, if you do it. But on yourself, you put the best what you can because you think, oh, it should be good. So he did all the repairing. And 4 weeks before he got the dizziness, he had a neighbor who told him a secret. It's good to have neighbors. They know secrets you don't know. And because he lived in a small community there in Germany, in the countryside, you know, everyone knows everyone, yeah? The neighbor said, you know what plans your mother-in-law has if her husband dies before her? Which is might probably be, or statistically, man die before woman. She will not give the house anymore to the daughter they have together, but for the son she had before she got married. And this son lives also in the same place, but he is the one that is poor because he didn't get in life very well. And now the man thinketh, all my work goes to whom? to this one who does not deserve it. Tell me what is it going on in his life? He thinks it's unfair, it's unrighteous what his mother-in-law wants to do him. So he is in a fight since then with the mother-in-law. And every time he comes home, his body reminds him of what? What is the recipe? What is the prescription for this man to get out of his dizziness? He should say, mother-in-law doesn't owe me anything. Well, that will not be an easy thing for him to do, would you? Because, you see, I had another patient. She was elderly also, and she came again and again because of her dizziness. And she had the same history, not with the mother-in-law, but with a neighbor. And so she came repeatedly to me, and I always encouraged her. I said, because she was elder, I said, but think well on your neighbor. Do him good. Don't fight against him. And suddenly she stopped and says, you're the friend of my neighbor. So I was her friend, wanting to help her, but she thought I want to help the neighbor. Because I said, be nice to your neighbor so that your dizziness disappears. You understand? We are fighting for things, and they make us physically sick. Because the physical must go and put into action that what the spiritual needs. You will always fight for your righteousness because it's a bigger need than something else. And that's my second proof for that we must have a spirit. It is that we have in life two things, two goals, I could say. And there is a contradiction. In the goal. We have here life and we have purpose. What do you think is when you come into a contradiction between life and purpose? What wins the battle? Let's say it more easy. If you want to live and you want righteousness, what would you always fight for, life or for righteousness first? Now I put this question on purpose because I know we answer it wrong. I would have answered like you. So let us go back to this first thing tonight, this evening. Is purpose life?
Yes.
Pardon?
Purpose gives you a reason and why you do the actions that you do on a daily basis.
Exactly. So the purpose is not the
life.
Never God created life to be the purpose. Did he create this plant to live? Is that the purpose why this plant lives? So the purpose is not life. Never ever life is purpose. But you see, in our evolutionary ideas, we think life is more important than purpose. Because some psychological things that we went to school, and we went to a school that taught us that the most and basic needs of life are, and we have that pyramid, you know, of the needs, and they say, until this is all physical, and this is spiritual. And I came to understand while I was talking to my patient that the pyramid is wrong. It's on the opposite. It's love that fills up, and a little bit we also need the physical needs. So let us look. We study today, I mean in this quarter, you might do it more or less, Job. The arch liar came and said, all a man has, he will give for his life. Is it true or is it false? On Job, God proves Job did give nothing on his life. Purpose was his issue, not life itself. So let us be clear in that. Never ever I saw one man in my practice, one patient, who lives for life's sake, because it's not possible. The car was not made for life's sake to exist. Was it made to exist for the existence? No, it was made to have a purpose. So in the conflict between purpose and life, what do you sacrifice? Always, without exception. Life. This should make us clear. Purpose is done through, is love service for man, and comes through our relationship. We will see that further on. And life is a means to fulfill the purpose. So we cannot mix them up. But you see, the devil takes out of a means and makes it a purpose, and then you're stuck. So let me ask you, a marriage is what? A mean or a purpose? Where would you put marriage? On the green or on the red? I know, think a little bit. It is just a mean. What is the church? A means or a purpose? A means to fulfill a purpose. But now we made out of marriage a purpose, and we made out of the church a purpose, and so we are stuck. We are dead. Because we haven't seen the switch that we are done. We live for the purpose to come to church. Yes, that's because we think to be in the church is the purpose. No, the church is just a means to fulfill a purpose. That's why life cannot be the purpose. Life is only the means. And I can prove this on animals as well. You know that? Animals have a soul. Does the Bible say that animal has a soul? Oh yes, for Bible students they know it. They have a spirit as well. And because, why they have a spirit? Because they have spiritual needs. Tell me, what is in the animal life more important? Life or purpose?
Purpose?
In the animal life. And we had a dog at home, and I can tell you many stories about that dog. But now, my wife convinced me to be agreeing on cats. And because the dog died, and then she brought me a cat, I agreed to one, she brought two, because the cat has a sister, or a brother. Now, since 2 weeks or 3 weeks, that was last year, the Lord somehow put the one cat to rest. So we have just one. But it was a sad event. Yeah, my wife was on Sabbath, the cat was caught by a car, and even though we live out in the country, there comes sometimes a car there, and so it hit the cat. And the neighbor found it, and so my wife wrote me, my Felix is dead. Just even my heart was tear in pieces because I saw her suffering on that. Yes? And now I see these cats. Do you think these cats need food? Yes. But do they come? You see, I never ever gave them food. because I'm not home to give cats food. But do you think they come to me? Why do they come? Immediately when I come home, they are there. They come, they want to see, to check what I brought. They are very curious cats, you know. They come and check, and they want to be, you know, and when she, and the poor guy who died, he was a humble cat. And the other one who survived, unfortunately, is not a humble cat. That cat does not go on your, on the end of the bed, you know, on your feet. That comes to want to sit on your face. You see, it's not, you know, it's not enough. If you let her on her feet, you know, she doesn't stay there because that's not the place. She must be on the pillow. If you leave, let her, she comes exactly onto your hand. Why? What's its her goal? What does he want? To feed her? No. And I could see how the cats are suffering when my wife is suffering. Because they are more dependent on my wife than on me, because I'm not so often home. But they come for love purpose. A cat lives first for love, then for food. There is no such thing, if we look to this world, that there is a purpose to survive, except to fulfill the purpose. There is no such thing that all evolves or arounds about survival. That's evolutionary and it's nonsense. Nothing in this world goes for survival. Because survival is a means, not a purpose. If survival would be the means, then everyone needs to take the place of another one. Then everyone is in a fight to each other. But I see nature something else. I see that everyone is present for the other, not a fight against each other. That there are some other things there too. We see and we experience in the life, in the animal life. But please, if we look to nature as well and look to it, we will see that the spiritual purpose is always superior to the physical one. We only want to live because we have a purpose. I heard a story about a patient that got liver carcinoma, and when they gave him the diagnosis, you know, this kind of cancer is growing very fast. He didn't have much time to live. And his first thought was that how he shared, he said, I will never lead my daughter to the altar. I will never see my grandchildren. What is that, life or purpose? I hope. Why did he want to live? For life's sake? No. You see, friends, we must put this very clear. If purpose is more important than life, then something must be there that in the conflict don't eat anymore. A cat can kill herself. And I have this story, and maybe tell this also for the children's sake. There was a patient coming to me just recently, and he had an hearing aid on his right side. And he has his hearing aid, and he has other issues. And I said, what's going on in your life? Because there's must something there that you have that pain. Because he was not hit, he had no infection, nothing was visible, but he has the pain. You know how much pain we have today in medicine that you cannot see and find? Yes, very much pain. And then we say that, well, that's psychosomatic. But he has it. There must be a reason for it. And he said, my dog is sick. And then he came, I asked him to come to counsel. He came, and during the counseling, his dog died. He had this great San Bernardino, so big dog. And he got devastated. He had so guilt thoughts that he could have saved maybe the dog. The dog was 9 years old. But what I found interesting in the story is that he had also a cat that is 12 years old, a cat. And the cat, of course, grew up together with the dog. And they were best friends. Said the cat was sleeping in the on the dog's breast. You know, the big dog, you know, we have had the same one. And imagine the small cat and the big dog, and they are just, no, it's a nice picture, isn't it? And now what happens after the death of the dog with the cat? You know, the cat get depressed. And he says she doesn't come in the house anymore. She goes and puts her body on the street where the cars go by. So the cars need to stop and go around. And he needs to go to pick her up and bring her in. And he says she eats sometimes, but she doesn't go anymore into the house to look around. She is totally depressed. And I said, you can do something for your dog, for your cat, if you get out of your depression. There is a power, yeah, we will see. But he is depressed as well, so he and the cat are in a issue. What kind of issue have? Do they have a life issue or a purpose issue? It's a purpose issue. Even the cat, and I have seen this cat get diabetes type 1. I had a patient whose cat got diabetes type 1 after the husband of the patient died, 6 months later. It is no thing. The cats have a spirit, and they get into trouble when their love source gets into trouble. And we'll see the law that is behind it, very plain. So there's a contradiction in us. Life without purpose is not worth living it. That's why people get into depression. That's why people get to be sick, because they have no purpose. And we will see that love is the purpose, because love is also means, but that makes us to move towards a purpose, because love must be the motivation of everything we do. So the third proof is that there is a hierarchy. Who is governing or commands? And who obeys? Is it the body or the spirit? So, let's look to the body. We know that the information that comes through the spirit comes through the body, comes out of the body through the spirit on the cortex level. Now, the body needs hunger or needs food, and it expresses that through hunger. Can the body force the spirit to eat? No. Can the spirit at all be forced to act? Can he? No. You can only make him suffering. That is, the spirit needs to feel the pain of the body when you torture the body. The fear that you can make the spirit a hard time, but you can never make him to move. He must move himself. Yeah? So this is a very important point to understand. We as men, can we be forced to do something or do it not? Can someone force you to do something or do it not? I hope we think that it's not possible. Yes, someone shake, maybe. If you do not, so to say, surrender and do it by yourself, not, can you force an animal? Have you tried to force a child? Mothers, have you tried to force the children? Does it work? It doesn't work. If they don't want to cooperate, you can do nothing. You're totally helpless. You're totally helpless. That's why it's very important. We can make the spirit a bad time through hunger, through sufferings, but we can never force him to act. If we can force him to act, then he has no responsibility for his actions. Who takes the responsibility then? I can say, oh, my wife forced me. Poor me. Or I was forced. I couldn't. Yes, we can be forced to put in jail. Yes, our body can be destroyed by force. But to act, to be obedient to someone, is never the action of another one. It's always our own. This is a very important point, because it shows that the spirit is higher than the body. So there's a hierarchy. So the hunger and the suffering, what do, the spirit? They just plead. They just ask for the fulfilling of the needs. But if your spirit does not want to eat anymore, will your body survive? No. Because he's dependent on the spirit to feed him. He's dependent on someone to take the decision, and that's only the spirit that can take the decision to eat or not to eat. But when the spirit thinketh, when thoughts that we have, what are they towards the body? Are they askings? Are they pleadings? Or are they commands? They are commands. So, whatever thought you have, it immediately changes the body. We can take that on the panic thought, as I know panic attacks from my own experience. And you know how, in how many splits of second your whole body changes? It's a little thought. It's even just you see something, yes? And something unconscious goes on there in your mind, and immediately your body is in alert situation. Because the spirit gave a command, and the body needs to act. So the body is always an instrument. It is never the one who acts by himself. It cannot act by himself. It was made that all actions are governed by the spirit. And I must say that I don't know everything, because I think that it's a very complex thing how the spirit governs the body to be alive. But I know that there are things that we can and must control in our lives through the way we think. And that needs to be in our control so that it may work. So we have to give the right commands so that it works well. So if the spirit commands the body, then what is stronger? It must be the spirit. You see, in science, we know and we call the spirit psyche. Yes? And in science, it is believed that the spirit or the psyche comes out of the cortex. So the cortex makes the spirit. But if the cortex would make the spirit, then the cortex, the body, would be the one that governs everything. Then the body needs must be first. And so that's why they follow their philosophy. When they make the diagram, they say physical needs are first. And then they bring emotional needs, which are all physical needs. So then you have no spiritual needs. So this they are through to their belief in evolution. Yeah? And they just follow clearly so that they don't get into a confusion there. But we should know better. If the spirit is made out of the body, then the body can feel and think. Then the body can have decisions. Then the cortex makes its own power, which is cause and effect. Possible? No. You see, when the cortex moves, the whole body, when the energy comes through, it must be because someone gave a command. So my fourth proof is the power, the energy thing. That is, if we can prove that through thoughts the brain gets energy, then we know the energy must come from inside the brain or from outside the brain. from outside the brain. So there must be there a spirit. We don't know him, we don't see him, but he must be there, because else he cannot, man cannot function. So what kind of energy? Thus, the spirit bring to the body. Because if he proved that the spirit brings energy to the body, then we must say he must be there, even though we don't see him. We cannot see the battery, but it must be there. He must be there because we cannot function. So my main or easiest point here is, what is the difference between a dead person and a living person? What is missing in a dead brain and what is missing is not missing in a living brain? It is the power. It's the spirit that is missing. Yes? When the spirit is missing, then you have no life. But you have a brain. It's all there. It's not damaged at all there, but it is no spirit anymore. So what kind of energy does the spirit bring to the body? It is life-giving energy. So what is the life-giving energy of the universe? For the spirit, it is love. What is it for the body? Electricity. Because the body does not know anything about love. Only the spirit knows what is righteousness and not. So, we can prove, everyone can prove it and see it, that without, when we do not think, yes, can we move? We must take decisions to move, yes? And that's why thoughts make the power. The will brings us up to the mountain. But we should be good to take some food with us so that we can have that as well as supplement. The will is not enough, is it? But when you have no will and you have a lot of supplement, can you climb the mountain? No. So you see, it's always two things, because we have a purpose, a spiritual thing, and we must have also the sustaining of the physical one. But the energy, the power, comes through the spirit, and love must be the energy. Jesus says so. Life comes from the spirit. The body does not, the flesh availeth nothing. My words are life and are spirit. So words are spiritual or physical? Spiritual, yes. You remember Jesus saying, man does not live by? Isn't that something so great? The devil says, if you don't eat, you die. And Jesus says, oh no, you're a liar. I cannot eat and I can still live, because I don't live from food alone. My life is dependent on my Father's hand. Could he keep Moses 40 days alive without any eating or drinking? Could he? Because he was in the presence of God. So the same way, he can do it in our lives as well. Can he? Yeah, so Jesus had to trust in God that he does not live by bread alone. It's so profound, so simple, and we still have not got it till today. Yes, we still believe life is in the food. Yes, we need food, but life is not in the food. Life is in the spirit. The flesh availeth nothing. So the life-giving power comes through the spirit. And the proof that we must have a spirit is that we can move, that we can act, is just the spirit's presence on our body to make us move. And I make this very simple analogy or picture, I don't know how to say it, between the piano and a player. Because in every place we have a piano. Now I show to this piano because this piano I cannot take as an example. Because that's a tricked piano. It looks like it can play alone.
Yes.
Can it?
Yes.
But it cannot. Do you believe that it plays alone?
No.
No. Someone needs to do something that piano can play. But this piano can how much play alone? No. It needs a
player.
So the body is the piano. The keys of the piano is the cortex. And the spirit is the player. Now, what is then the soul? Because the Bible says, out of the breath of life and the dust became a man a living soul. And where is this living soul located? The living soul located is on the cortex level. This is here, the living soul. But, and there can be only a living soul, you know? The dead soul is not existent. Yeah, he died. So what is, if the piano is the body, and the spirit or the player, don't have the spirit, but we have a piano player, is the spirit. What is the soul? What? The music is the soul. How much music do you have when the piano is not working and the player wants to play? How much can the piano play without the player? So you see, there is a unity there that is inseparable if you want to have music. It's not possible. This is the way how God created us. Who makes the sound? The player or the piano? Now, let's take just this. If I push that button, who makes the sound? The piano makes the sound. So, that's why in this very nice book, Ministry of Healing, what I recommend to you is, Elwhite says, it is only through the medium of the body that we can make a good character. Because the music is healed through the body. That's why on the body I can say if the piano player plays well or not. Because he can play as he wants, but the piano will prove is the play is correct or not. I can say to you, I can play the piano. Will you believe me? If I never demonstrated to you, would you? I would never believe someone who can play the piano. And I could go to that piano and I have learned only one song. And I can play that a little bit. Yeah, but not more than that. But who will prove if I can play the piano? The piano itself. Is that so hard to understand? It's a simple analogy. For children it's not, but maybe for us as adults. You see, the medium of the expression of all our deeds we can do only through the body. That's why the body proves if we do right or if we do wrong. This is my main argument. When a patient comes to me and he's sick, I say, you play your piano wrong. Because if you would play it correctly, the piano would sound like a nice music. No pain, no discord, no tension, no dizziness, no ear singing, nothing. You would have nothing in your body if the spirit would just play that piano correctly. I cannot know what you think. I have never seen a spirit, but I have seen a body and I hear a music. And that is my orientation. So we must orient on something that is objective. Is the piano able to lie? No. He can never lie. He can be broken, but what he says is exactly that, what is the thing there. That's why it's so simple. I see my patients, and I only see the piano. I only see the body. But I know there is a player there by law, because you would never believe if the piano would play by himself, would you? Even if you would see the claps going down. Would you believe that he plays himself? You would never do it, because you know for sure, even though your senses might lie to you what you see, you would say, that's not possible. There must be some demon or someone playing that piano. Because it's not possible to be played by itself. And you would not believe it. Because you would know it's a trick. It's something that cannot be. And this is law. We must know we have an effect in the body. The body effect can never come from the body itself. So if we get that, we have got a lot. If our pianos don't work well, it's because the one that rules that piano doesn't play well. Because all decisions you take, whether you eat or drink, you sleep or act, is whose decision? The piano's decision? No. On the piano, you only see if those decisions are correct. The piano proves the player, if you understood it or not. I so like simplicity. I don't know if you like simplicity. I'm a fan of simplicity. Now, simple things might be the most hard for us to understand. But it's a law of cause and effect. And we can prove it. When the spirit is not there, the piano doesn't play anymore. He gets rotten and he gets eaten by the worms. But as long as the spirit is there, the piano is not eaten by the worms, he is still a living being and plays more or less well. Yes, sounds, better to say, sounds more or less well. So I hope tonight that we got to this point,
yes.
And we will see tomorrow, why does the piano player play wrong? That means, who makes the diseases? If we have a spirit that plays our body, and we are bodily sick, and we can exclude the external causes, who makes the sickness? We ourselves. You see, the gentleman has dizzy, makes the dizziness himself, because he pushes some buttons there on the nervous system that are not loving buttons. Yes? They are pushed, and the nerve says, this hurts. And boom, you have the back sound, the bad sound of the piano, the bad sound of your body. So we want to know, why do we make ourselves sick, even though we want to be healthy? Even though we want to live a good life, I came to understand, is it wrong to want righteousness? Is it wrong? But you know, most diseases come because you fight for righteousness. So there must be some misunderstanding there in our way of perceiving things. That instead of knowing how to fulfill that need, we don't fulfill it correctly and we get into trouble. And our body will show it, because our body is dependent totally on righteousness. Not that the body knows anything about righteousness, but a spirit that has righteousness plays well. Spirit that has no righteousness is in a bondage. He is in a fight, and he will destroy the body. So, are there any questions for tonight's lectures? Yes.
Yeah, Genesis chapter 2, verse 17. The Bible talks about because Adam and Eve ate, God promised, there was a promise, thou shalt surely die. And because of that promise, we're dying today until Christ restores us.
Well, I didn't understand the question.
Yeah, because the question, well, I'm making a statement, but also the question, he says, because the things we're doing, that we die. Yes, I believe that with the eating right and doing all these things, it preserved life a little longer. But the Bible says, after Adam and Eve, remember in the Garden of Eden, if you eat from this tree of life, thou shalt surely die. And that's a promise.
Yes. Now this is possible because we can walk with God and understand ourselves like Christ understood himself. And he never played his piano one yacht wrong. Now, I played it wrong. I have many things. But I want to go backwards. From a playing wrong, I want to learn how to play well. And one day, want to just put the button, like Job did. Job is, for me, a very good example. It's possible. Enoch is an example. It is possible. It's possible to overcome, to play the piano well. And then, I think disease might be as well something that is just at the border of our souls. So, another question.
He was actually saying is exactly what you were saying. If you were to chase life, you would surely die.
Exactly.
And so you, by learning how to listen to the Spirit, therefore you will have a purpose in life and you learn how to play your piano. So that verse in Genesis actually applies to what you were teaching.
Yeah, of course, I think it is no contradiction. But it's a good point that we understand life or death is inherited, yes? But we live in the last generation and I want to overcome even this first death, if it's possible. But if I die, that's also fine.
Can you clarify a little further exactly what he meant by we don't do this for health, we do this for purpose, because it's not a part of your purpose to prosper and be in health?
Amen. So, of course, it is my purpose that we should be healthy, because the function need to be good so that I can fulfill the purpose. But I don't go for function, I go for purpose. Why do you wash your car? Why do you give her good gas? Why would you preserve the car? That you should use her, yes? So we will see not fulfilling the purpose destroys our function. Okay? Yes, the aim. So I want us to be healthy, of course. That's why I do this. But health is not the goal in itself. We need to understand there is a higher goal in life than to seek health. And yes, we need health as a means, but it's not a goal and an ultimate thing to fulfill our purpose, why God did us in this world. That's why we want to search, because they are combined together, you know. Function and purpose are combined together. And you will see that if we don't understand the purpose of the Spirit, he destroys the body. And we will see how deceived we are in his heart. Please.
Yeah, you mentioned Spirit. Are you talking the Holy Spirit, conscience? You said that because the Bible talks about when God created man, breath of the dust of the earth, breath yes. of life, and man became a living being.
Yes.
And when you're talking about Spirit, when you're talking about the conscience, where the Holy Spirit controls the mind.
I'm talking about the elements that we are made out. Yes? And when we have water, how many elements do we have? Two. Let me ask you, is the oxygen in the water something else than oxygen?
No.
So let us take again the law and the principle. When God created man, he took a piece of dust. Yes? And he formed that in a body, but it was nothing there. And then he took a breath of life. Yes?
Right.
And they both come together. And in a moment they come together, they are making the living soul. But now, we all know that out of the dust, what becomes in the soul? What's in the living soul? We don't have dust. We have a body. And in the living soul, we have a spirit that came out of the breath of life. Together with the body, the breath of life becomes spirit and the dust becomes body. Now comes death here. If death comes in, what happens out of the spirit? It is just a breath of life, and out of the body becomes a piece of dust. I think there is nothing more simple than that. But we have a problem. We think that we are an amalgamation between spiritual and physical things. But it is not so, since the spiritual cannot combine with the physical. They can only work together. You cannot combine love and atoms, so to say. You can only make them work together. That's why the Bible is very clear. There is one Bible verse in 1 Thessalonians 5:23 that says, we should be prepared and be perfect in our... Where? You know the Bible verse? Let's read it. So, we have a long night, I have time. So let's go to 1 Thessalonians 5:23. It's the only Bible verse when we have all three things together. In the rest of the body, in the rest of the Bible, there is no such thing like this. It says, and the very God of peace sanctify you wholly, and I pray God your whole spirit and soul and body. Now, are these distinct things?
Yes.
So can ever the body be spirit? I hope that we understand that. So here in my picture, it's very simple. This is the spirit that must come first, because we start in the spirit. Then comes the soul, and the soul is not in the whole body, it's just on the cortex. Just because the spirit is on the cortex, and there they work together, and from there everything starts, you don't have a spirit in your finger. You cut out the finger, and how much did you cut out of your soul? Nothing, because the soul is still there, whole, just your body has something that is missing there. Yes? So, and down under the cortex, from here down, you have pure body. And Ellen White is very clear on this. So read and search for it, because she says that we have higher powers and lower powers. And she says where the lower and the higher power are located. She says the lower powers, this is passion and appetite, are located in the body. And the higher powers are located in the soul. And we know that the passions are located in the limbic system because they are physical. So we know that the soul must be the cortex and the spirit where we have the judgment, where we have consciousness, where we have also the subconscious, where we have the will, where we have all our actions do come from the soul. That's why I make this so. This is the place where we live, is in the soul. Everything we do in the soul. But it's the spirit who does in the soul the smelling. Yes? Who smells? The body or the spirit? So only the spirit can smell. Who hears what I now say? The spirit hears, but it goes through the ear and goes to the limbic system, comes up here and presents to the spirit the information. And if I would speak to you in German, would you understand? Or Romanian or whatever language? Because your spirit knows only one language, or maybe two, but that, because the spirit learns the languages, not the body. The spirit, but the spirit put all the language information in the body so he can remember the word that he once learned when he hears it again. So there is a continual exchange. Every information comes to the spirit, but he then puts it into the body. So when you have a damage in the body, then you have a memory loss because the spirit cannot read the information anymore. So Ellen White says it on many places. It should be our study to study the relationship between the mind and the body. She said it should be the first thing that should be studied in our school, in Christ's object lesson, read it. It's all spread out there. But we have no understanding of the spirit. You know why? And I thank you for this question, because I was last Sabbath in the Romanian church in Loma Linda, and I did a short presentation of an hour and something, trying to put as much as in it, but the main purpose was to understand the spirit, and the pastor comes at the end and says, please explain to me the spirit. And I said, I only met people who are pastors that don't understand it. And I was laughing. I said, well, it's so simple. Because you see, we are taught in our schools that we are physical. We are just physical. That's why we have a problem. The Bible says in Romans 8 that the Spirit of God talks to the spirit of man. Is it there wordly? Do you remember the Bible verse? Yes? So who talks to us? The Spirit of God. But to whom does it talk? To my brain? To my spirit. Ellen White has a nice quote where she says, everything is governed by the Spirit. He connects us to God. He connects us to the heavenly world. And all the physical organs are the subjects, the servant of the mind. And she uses the term spirit because it's the same, so in her understanding. So Romans 8, 12, is it? For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. For ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but ye have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, the Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit. Is it there? Mm-hmm. That we are children of God. And then let's do the other Bible verse as well. 1 Corinthians 2:11, where it says, who knows anything in man? For what man knoweth the things of a man, save the spirit of man which is in him? Even so the things of God knoweth no man but the Spirit of God. So are there two distinct spirits there or not? I hope it's evident. Because how could I be ever responsible if I would have not my own spirit to act on my own? How could I? So that's why God made us. Yes, and the Bible, and if you want to study the human heart, we will come in these other hours to that place. You will see in Ecclesiastes, Solomon, the wisest man that lives on earth after Jesus, he knew it all, how it works. So we must have a basic understanding, because what misses us, what we miss in medicine is not that we don't see the body, but we miss in medicine is that we have a spirit. It's a fundamental thing. Before we can understand that the body does not function well, we must know there must be a cause for that body to function, and that is the spirit. The spirit is not the power of the body. He just brings the power that he takes from God that the body should live. So I think that's undoubtable, and it shouldn't be undoubtable for us in everything. That piano can never play itself if it has no player. This body cannot function if it has no spirit. That's as plain as it can be. Because by the law, I have an effect here. And this effect is not, it's seeable, it's a body, but the spirit makes it. Without spirit, I lay down and dead. Yeah? So the spirit is, this law of cause and effect, I tell you, is so important that we understand where you have the effect, you don't have the cause. Now, this is so basic. We would not mess up our judgment at all if we just would understand that piano, this body, this heart can never beat by itself. It is made to be beat by our own spirit's responsibility. Now, God has put there certain things that we don't understand how that all works. But we know through my thoughts, I can change the heartbeat. Through my thoughts, I can change a lot in my body. Because ultimately, I have responsibility for my body. And the Bible says, bring your body as a living sacrifice. How?
Holy.
And it should be, that is your reasonable service. So let us understand. Our reasonable service is to play the piano well. It will be seen in our body how good we play or not. So, thank you very much. It was a long evening. God bless you.